Peter Frampton is one of the greatest guitar players ever. And today we're going to look at the greatest guitar story ever, the story of Peter Frampton's Phenix Les Paul guitar. The story is incredible. Let's check it out. Peter Frampton is an American and English rock musician, singer, songwriter, and producer. Peter first became interested in music when he was 7 years old. He taught himself how to play guitar as well as piano. At the age of 8, he began taking classical music lessons.
I had a Les Paul, and it was a Black Beauty, when I was in the herd, probably in late 67, something like that. It wasn't until Humble Pie that I started first with the Gretsch that's on the wall behind me, because Steve had one too, Marriott. So we had dueling duo jets. And then I went to the SG and started to really love that. That was the first time I played real humbuckers. Just before we hit San Francisco to play the Fillmore West with Humble Pie, I had part exchanged the SG for a 335. Every time I played a note, it fed back, you know, like badly, not goodly. Not goodly feedback. So it was the most frustrating thing, you know. So this guy that we'd known, a fan in the audience, afterwards, Marc Mariana is his name, and he said, "Oh, Peter, I couldn't help but notice you were having a little problem there." So I said, "Yeah, you could say so." And he said, "I've got this Les Paul that I just got refinished, came back from Gibson." And I opened up the case, and it was this, you know, but brand new looking. And, you know, when you open the case and you look at it, you go, wow, that's like the Miracles, 1957, that cover. When he got it, it was a Black Beauty. It was a 1954 Black Beauty. So it was almost exactly the guitar that I didn't like. He fitted it for two and then had them routed, or he routed it for the third pickup. Meanwhile, he'd hand shaved the neck and the body. It's thinner than most Les Pauls because he overdid it with the sanding. I play the guitar that night and I don't think my feet touched the ground. I mean, it was just so thrilling that I didn't feed back to start with. And secondly, it felt like I'd played it all my life, you know? And so I came off stage after the last show and said to Marc, "I love this guitar, but I don't expect that you'd ever want to sell it." He said, "Nope." I said, "Yeah, that's what I thought." He said, "Nope, I'm gonna give it to you." So he gave it to me.
We'll be right back.
we're playing now in South America in 1980, and we'd played Argentina, and then we played Venezuela, and the next place to go is Panama. So we flew, for the first time without the gear, we flew to Panama for a day off to wait for the gear to play the following day. They'd loaded the gear into a cargo plane. We don't think it was loaded correctly, unfortunately, and the straps broke or something, because they have to put everything up front. It slipped and the wing touched. So it was not off, it was this far off the ground, you know. And having filled up with fresh new Venezuelan oil, they couldn't get near it for 5 hours.
Go shopping with Frampton at Gary's Classic Guitars in Cincinnati.
Is this more like the George Harrison one?
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see how much the instrument means to him. He's bought several guitars here, in part to replace the Gibson Les Paul he lost in 1980. Then, 2 years ago, out of nowhere.
There's an email with pictures of what looks like my guitar.
Well, you know, someone apparently rescued the guitar from the burning plane. Apparently it was the only thing that was rescued from the burning plane. Apparently the guitar then got sold to a Curacao musician who brought it to Curacao. And, you know, the guitar has been here in Curacao all these years.
But nobody knew it.
Nobody knew it. And it appeared 2 years ago when a custom officer that we have here, Donald Valentina, who is someone who also loves guitars and he collects vintage guitars and he fixes guitars for friends as a hobby, they brought the guitar to him, you know, to get fixed. And then he recognized the guitar.
Yeah, it's pretty recognizable. I mean, aside from being a great-looking Gibson Les Paul, it's got three electric pickups on it. Peter had it kind of styled for his own uses.
Exactly. He had it styled. So when Donald saw the guitar, he knew, he investigated it, and he was totally convinced. And for 2 years, he's been trying to buy the guitar from the musician. But the musician never had a reason to sell the guitar. He was happy with the guitar. Of course, it's a beautiful guitar. And he was playing it, you know, at hotels and bars and here on the island. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were convinced this was Peter Frampton's guitar. And I wanted to make sure that Curacao gave back Mr. Peter Frampton back his guitar, because, you know, we understood that there were other people, because the musician finally decided to sell it. So there were other people who were also interested. So we wanted to make sure we moved quickly on it, because if it fell and maybe probably in someone else's hands, you know, this guitar would have never gotten back to its original owner. We moved very quickly and we made sure that we secured the guitar so that we could eventually, you know, give it back to Peter.
My guitar.
Okay.
It's the guitar.
Oh, man.
Yeah. It's in remarkable condition considering that it's been in a plane crash.
So how's it gonna feel to get it back on stage?
Oh, I don't know how I'm gonna handle that. I hope I can play.
Last night at the Beacon Theater in New York, after 31 years, guitar and musician were reunited on stage.
That's about 1 minute after I first knew I got the guitar back right there. I spoke to the gentleman. I spoke to the gentleman that gave me this guitar in 1970. Today, just before we left for the show, and it was a very emotional call because when he gave it to me, he didn't even charge me anything for it. He just gave it to me because he thought that it was something that I should have for whatever reason. And when we lost it in the plane crash in 1980, it was very sad, obviously, as well as, you know, people lost their lives and everything. So 31 and a half years later, I find out that it didn't burn up in the plane crash at all. Here it is. This is the first time I'm going to play it with the band.
Hit the band and face the music.